evening. Tonight we record a controversial broadcasting anniversary. This week, Radio Caroline celebrates its 20th birthday. It was launched back in 1964, in the days when radio broadcasting in Britain was the monopoly of the BBC. Well, since those early days, we've had, of course, the Marine Broadcasting Act designed to ban the pirates from the airwaves, and the birth and the continued growth of independent local radio. But while other pirate radio ships, most of them broadcasting off the Essex coast, have come and gone, Caroline has more or less carried on regardless. But as Daniel Britton reports, there's mounting concern in both the Independent Broadcasting Authority and the government about the continued existence of the pirate stations.
Loving awareness is free. Is free. Is free.
Steve Phillips on a Wednesday afternoon. This is Caroline. This fella is Paul McCartney.
There's a man who plays the game of life so well.
We're worried about the continued existence of all pirate radios, whether on land or sea. I mean, they have a buccaneering image, but they're bogus, really, because they do a lot of harm to existing broadcasting. They interfere with frequencies, they pinch copyright, and we are anxious to discourage and do away with them as much as we can. We think it is grossly unfair and wrong that people who are playing by the rules should be subjected to unfair competition. The system allows competition. That's the difference between our system and many others in the world. We encourage competition, but it has to be competition within the rules, which keeps up standards, preserves copyright, and so on.
Radio Caroline Headline News, brought to you by Newsweek Magazine.
The Lebanon's President Gamal has arrived in the capital of Syria, Damascus, to a full diplomatic welcome.
When Radio Caroline came on the air on March 28, 1964, it was a news event in itself. In those far-off days, Sir Alec Douglas Hume was Prime Minister, cigarettes were just 5 and 6 a packet, and petrol 5 bob a gallon. Billy J. Kramer's Little Children was number one in the charts.
You better tell on me. I'm telling you.
Like any ship at sea, Caroline has suffered a lot of rock and roll, and even ups and downs. But her first appearance on air was a shock to everyone.
And a quarter, if you quiet, like you ought to be. And keep the secret with me. I wish they would go away, little children.
You're tuned to Radio Caroline on 199, your all-day music station.
Simon Dee was the disc jockey who brought Caroline on the air. He'd never done any broadcasting before, and after a few weeks aboard, he was still getting used to the job.
How long have you been on board yourself?
Long time, long time. How long have I been on board? Six weeks.
It seems to me, and I'm not being unkind, you could do with the rest.
Yes, I could do with the rest.
But feeling a little bit neurotic, are you?
Well, a little bit, yes. You know, I'm smoking about 60 of these things a day, and, but it's, you know, it's all happening. It's great to be in the middle of it all.
What don't you like about it?
Don't I like about it? I don't like not getting enough sleep, but apart from that, fine.
Throughout its 20-year history, the brains behind Caroline has been Ronan O'Rahilly, an Irishman who was just 23 when Caroline projected itself onto the airwaves. His mother was American, and his fascination with the Kennedy era led to the name of Caroline.
Kennedy was in office. He was the youngest president. There was a lot of idealism. Turned on a lot of young people all over the world, you know, to sort of, you know, it was that kind of feeling that anything was possible. And I remember I opened a magazine, Life, A Look, one of these magazines that you tend to read cover to cover when you're on these transatlantic flights. And there was a picture of Caroline Kennedy, kind of in the Oval Office at the age of 3. And Jack was on his hands and knees and was like, playing with her as opposed to attending world events or world affairs. And it was something, the headline was Caroline Smiles and Disrupts Government or some sort of caption like in that sort of context. And I just thought, well, that'd be a fabulous name for the station.
and Caroline's been disrupting governments ever since. Within 6 weeks of coming on air, Caroline was joined by another pirate, Radio Atlanta, and soon the quiet Essex port of Brightlingsea became the transit point for DJs setting out for the ships. Ex-Atlanta DJ Colin Nicol remembers the scene well.
Colin, it must be nearly 20 years since you were last down here.
I think it's 20 years to the day, Daniel, just about, since I first came to Brightlingsea, and I haven't been here since. It's the first time. We used to come down the night before very often and stay at Jacob's Hall, sleep overnight, get up 4 or 5, very early in the morning anyway, and then find our way down this slipway here to the barge waiting for us at the bottom end. Then we'd head out, and very often the weather wasn't even as good as it is right now.
Anyone who ever loved could look at me.
Within a matter of weeks, though, financial necessity drove Atlanta and Caroline into alliance. However, no one told Colin Nicol.
Suddenly, the radio ship Caroline hove to on the horizon. We threw ourselves into a panic because we didn't know what was going on. We immediately thought some kind of piratical shenanigans were about to occur, and we hid everything of value, including spare crystals and pickup heads for the turntables and so on. Simon D came aboard and said, "There's been a merger. We're taking over." And I said, "Well, hang on a bit. Let's get this straight." So we both sent telexes ashore. And in a little while, Ronan O'Reilly, Alan Crawford, a number of other people came out to the ship from here, from Brightlingsea, told us the merger was on, that I could have a couple of weeks' rest since I'd been on for 6 weeks solid. Caroline went live as Radio Caroline South and was no longer Radio Atlanta, and the old Caroline ship sailed around and became Caroline North.
Status 4 in Loving You. If you just join us, welcome along. It's the Tony Blackburn Show from Radio London. It's your chance now to...
In the middle of 1964, Caroline hired Tony Blackburn. But having found a career that was all at sea, one night he suddenly found himself washed ashore.
Radio London! London's number one!
I was doing the breakfast show on Radio Caroline, so I was fast asleep in bed, and a guy called Norman St. John, he came down and he said, "You better get up because we're going into shore." And it was something we'd always joked about anyway. So I said, "You know, oh, come on, go. You must be joking." So anyhow, about 5 or 6 minutes later, the captain came down and he said, "You really must get up." So I went up. I remember going up. I remember getting dressed, and I went up, and all the lights of Frinton were all round. And I thought, "God, it's actually happening." And we still thought we were about a mile and a half out because it was dark, and it was a very high sea. It was about a 10-4 scale, and the waves were crashing over. And I remember the captain, he got this massive great searchlight, because we didn't have radar on board, and he just shone this light just to the side of the boat. And I remember it looked about 100 yards away. There were just people walking along the seashore. And I remember in a very low voice, he shouted out, "Mayday." And it's, nobody really took it. The slightest bit of advice. There's a crunching sound. Just literally, we just beached. Then the breeches boy came over, because the lifeguards were there, and I was the first on there. And I was the first off. There was no sense of panic or anything. It was just like another adventure, really. We didn't really quite know what was going on. But the waves, I remember, were really crashing all over the boat. But it was the most amazing experience.
Right from Caroline's first broadcast, the government looked for ways of putting the station off the air. The 1949 Wireless Telegraphy Act banned the transmission and reception of unlicensed broadcasts. But the idea of taking millions of Caroline listeners to court was distinctly impractical. In 1967, Harold Wilson's Labour government passed the Marine Offences Act. It banned advertising by British companies and prevented British citizens from supplying the pirates with anything from food to records. And it banned British DJs. That law is still in force. It was too much for the dozen pirate radio stations which were on the air. So by midnight of 14th August 1967, amidst a mass of farewell parties, they stopped transmissions. All except one. Ronan O'Reilly considered then, as now, that if he could comply with the conditions laid down, he could continue broadcasting.
What are you doing here tonight?
supporting free radio.
How can you support them now they're going off the air?
Keep listening.
But if they go off the air, how can you keep listening?
Well, they're going to do it illegally, aren't they? So well, keep listening.
So you're going to give your support to Caroline?
Yes.
I mean, they've estimated about 25 million people were tuning in that night. And of course, everybody wanted to see, you know, what would happen, whether we would do it, and whether at a minute past midnight this great tone would come on, the government would try jamming it. If anything, it was a bit of an anticlimax, because the station was very short-staffed. There was a couple of journalists out there who wanted to be present when we moved into sort of so-called illegality. And we celebrated with Weetabix and a bottle of champagne. And the next day, it was a bit of an anticlimax. We're expecting to see, you know, naval ships bearing down on us from the horizon, but sort of nothing happened. So we just carried on.
Up until the act was passed, Caroline had some very plush London headquarters.
And it was here that the advertising was sold and the DJs called in their trips ashore. But the 1967 Marine Offences Act put an end to all that, and the headquarters was moved from here to Amsterdam. And judging by the building now, it looks if no one's been back since.
The post office, who of course were charged with putting us off the air, actually would come round in their vans and say, everything all right with the mail service round here, you know? I mean, for an illegal setup, we were just very much a part of the London scene. These chaps from the city used to sort of come round once a week and have a board meeting and discuss the sort of financial figures. And Ronan, of course, money was to him something that was just a trifling thing not to be bothered with. And into the boardroom, there used to be this wonderful ornate lift, and Ronan used to be upstairs, and the city would gather around the board table. And Ronan would descend, rumoured to be on various psychedelics, and sort of with eyes popping out, would then proceed to zap all these fellows from the city and, you know, tell them how groovy everything was. And not to worry.
The 1970s were tough years for Caroline, with other countries passing their own Marine Offences Acts. The station had a succession of names: Radio Seagull, 199, Mi Amigo, Atlantis, and even more. Dutch programmes were transmitted in between the English services. By 1980, the 59-year-old Panama-registered Mi Amigo was little more than a floating hulk. She could no longer stand the terrible North Sea storm. Then, one night, Buster Pearson, one of Caroline's most devoted listeners, who has monitored every broadcast from the station since the opening in 1964, picked up bad news from the ship.
Well, I was expecting trouble, because about, it was around 2 o'clock in the afternoon, the Dutch programming that was on from 6 in the morning till 6 at night was interrupted, and one of the English DJs came on and gave a series of numbers out, and they would only do that if something very important had happened on the boat. And that was done several times throughout the afternoon, and it did look as though something very serious was going on. And we were listening throughout the evening, and the numbers were going out every 2 or 3 hours, and I found out afterwards that they meant, you know, main anchor chain broken, the emergency one had been put down or something like that. And then at midnight they came on and said that they were leaving the boat, and it was came as a, you know, we'd stunned. We couldn't believe that it was that serious, because they had been programming right up to the very last.
This is a Caroline gale warning.
We're sorry to tell you that due to the severe weather conditions, and also to the fact that we're shipping quite a lot of water, we're closing down, and the crew are at this stage leaving the ship. Obviously, we hope to be back with you as soon as possible, but we'd just like to assure you all on land that there's nothing to worry about. We're all quite safe. Just for the moment, we'd like to say goodbye. Tom?
Yeah, it's not a very good occasion, really. I have to hurry this, because the lifeboat is standing by. We're not leaving and disappearing. We're going onto the lifeboats, hoping that the pumps can take it. If they can, we'll be back. If not, well, I don't like to say it.
I think we'll be back one way or another,
yeah,
Tom.
I think so.
Unfortunately, their optimism was a little misplaced. The Mi Amigo sank on March the 20th, 1980. and nothing more was heard for 3.5 years. But in August last year, Caroline returned.
In her 20-year history, Radio Caroline has transmitted from 3 ships. This one is the largest of all. It's the Ross Revenge, a former Grimsby trawler, but now converted to, I'm told, one of the best radio ships in the world. Underneath me, there's 250 tons of cement, and that acts as ballast for the largest radio mast on any ship in the world, 300 feet.
From a point at sea to the circles in your mind, this is the new Radio Caroline.
With a permanent cook on board, the Ross Revenge is like a floating hotel, though she probably wouldn't warrant a very high star rating. She's home to half a dozen DJs and a crew of 6. Everyone works in monthly shifts, but is it really worth the legal risks involved?
It doesn't worry me as such, because I think it's worth the risk. There's a certain rebellious element, I suppose, in all of us, otherwise we wouldn't be here. But as yet, no problems really at all. I just do it because I enjoy it and because I like the music. And it's as simple as that.
What are the risks?
I don't know. I think it's about £400 fine and 6 months in prison or something. Yeah.
Do you get a lot of audience response, Robin?
Well, you can see looking at this, I mean, we categorise them all into European countries because different times of the day and night, various countries can hear you. Obviously, we're better at night in Scandinavia. But Holland, you can see we've got loads from Holland, Belgium, France, Britain. And we get sort of this amount we would get every time we get mail, at least that sort of amount. Well, I mean, there's a few hundred in there every time. And the response from mail is amazing. It's the only way you can contact us, because you can't exactly call us up on the phone, either.
I see the letters are all addressed to America, and the British Post Office is not allowed to deliver to you. How do these letters get here?
Spain.
Spain?
Well, Spain isn't covered by the Marine Offences Act, so everything we get comes from Spain. So obviously it goes to New York, which again hasn't got a Marine Offences Act. Then it goes through Spain and arrives here by boat.
This is Europe's first and only album station.
Steve, if I can interrupt you a moment, why are you working here on Caroline and not on land somewhere leisurely, I suppose?
It's a challenge. Me versus the sea, and at the moment I think the sea's winning.
Yeah. Why do you enjoy it, though?
Well, it's the most famous radio station in the world, Radio Caroline. And it's just an opportunity that I just couldn't miss. So I'm here.
And how long do you stay out on the ship?
Just depends. 5 weeks, 4 weeks, 5 weeks. Depends how things go. Depends on the sea, actually.
Not Is really that pretty bad us. At times?
It can get very bad. I will vouch for that, yeah.
With its powerful 50-kilowatt transmitter, Caroline's broadcast can be picked up clearly throughout most of the southern half of England. But listeners have picked up the signal as far away as Algeria. She costs £1,000 a day to keep afloat. So how is Caroline financed?
Any radio station depends on audience, and commercial radio station. And we've got a large audience, and we've got, as you know, a big number of international clients on the air now. Newsweek and Jordache Jeans and Priority Airfare, to name but a few. And they are quite happy with what's happening, and they're happy with what they're getting, because they are American corporations and Canadian.
Well, you say to name but a few, actually, you've named nearly all of them. There are only 5 advertisements that Caroline transmits. How can you make money out of that?
Well, there's 5, because that's the... There's 5, I think there's 6, actually, but, I mean, that is the big... That's the beginning. We only started commercials just over a month ago, so that's the beginning, and then there's a reaction to that, and then you develop from there.
Dirk Commissar from After the Fire on 729 kilohertz, 411 meters, a test transmission that will be concluding here in about 36 minutes.
In spite of the possible legal risks, Caroline is soon to be joined by another ship, Radio Laser. The growth of pirates, both land and sea-based, is a serious worry to the IBA, the body which licenses independent local radio.
We believe that the government could take much more vigorous action within the present law than is already happening, and I was very heartened indeed by the response I got from the Home Secretary when I raised this matter with him strongly recently, and he has promised to look for more vigorous action from the prosecuting authorities in this country. At the same time, there is a new bill, a telecommunications bill, going through Parliament, which will, I think, strengthen the powers of dealing with this. I ought perhaps to say I know very well that piracy has a certain sort of romantic flavour to it. Piracy in this field is straightforward theft. Theft of property from decent working radio journalists, broadcasting journalists like yourself.
Any new pirates cause us anxiety, and we will do what we can to stop them. The IBA, Lord Thompson and the IBA, have come to us recently and said, for heaven's sake, step it up, because the competition is wholly unfair, and we are now discussing with them and the other government departments involved here as to how we can best do that.
15 minutes before 1 o'clock on a Wednesday afternoon, Indians in Moscow and Naughty Miranda, Sons of Heroes, Strange Eyes and Paul McCartney, The Man, Steve Phillips, on a Wednesday afternoon for Caroline.
I think the kind of choice that you get in radio broadcasting in this country now, with a vast network of ILR stations and BBC local radio stations, together with the main BBC national services, it provides a full range of choice and quality. I don't think the pirates provide anything that is not provided on public service broadcasting, but they do it on the cheap. And they do it on the cheap because they are able to get away with the lower standards. They don't pay royalties on the music that they put out, and that sort of thing.
But can you condemn someone like Radio Caroline for not paying those Performing Rights Society payments? And of course it would be illegal for them to accept the money, the PRS.
Radio Caroline is in a rather different position because it is, of course, operating outside United Kingdom territorial waters. Nevertheless, the Marine Offences Act applies to it and to anybody who supplies it. And Radio Caroline is using a frequency that is an IBA frequency that is available for the service, the proper service of listeners in this country.
Essex Radio, the ILR station based in Southend, acknowledges that it has lost listeners to Caroline amongst the 18 to 25 age group. It's not so much the competition as standards which worry the station's chief executive.
What I'm cross about is the differing standards that apply to broadcasting in this country. On the one hand, we can tolerate the offshore activities of pirate broadcasters and land-based pirate broadcasters who pay no rates, rights, duties or anything else. And on the other hand, our commercial radio companies, such as ours, are restricted and hampered by all sorts of conditions which are imposed on us by government and by the IBA. Therefore, if the government imposes those conditions, they should take active steps to ensure that every other broadcaster abides by them.
Of course, the other thing is equally true. You'd like to be free of the rules and conditions to put out a programme like Caroline's.
We'd be delighted to be much freer. Of course we would. Our costs then would be much lower. Our costs are astronomical.
On 319 meters, with love, peace, and good music.
I don't sit down thinking, how can I know the British government today? That is not the purpose. No, I enjoy the fact that Caroline is alive and well and out there, knowing that it is a free radio station. I mean, it is very, very romantic. I am a bit romantic and idealistic in my approach to it.
In its 20 years of broadcast, Radio Caroline has been rather more popular with its listeners than the authorities who've tried to put it off the air. First, they used the Wireless Telegraphy Act, and then the Marine Broadcast Defences Act. But as Radio Caroline enters its third decade of transmitting,
This looks like one battle the pirates are winning.